burden runs off my shoulders. How can I hurt when holding you?
And so we have an opportunity to do something that's never been done in Connected History before. If you are able to, I'm asking you to stand up.
Touching warm.
Hurry up. Because in a second, we're going to sing the words of this song. And I want you to sing very loud because it's going to be epic. Here we go. Don't leave me hanging.
Sweet Caroline. Good times never seem so good. I've been inclined.
Thank you so much. Give yourselves a round of applause. You can sit down. Well, that was awesome. Scratch that off your things to do list. Sing with 700 of my closest friends. It's amazing what we can do with the right motivation. For instance, what motivated you to sing right now? Was it because you love Neil Diamond? Maybe because it seemed fun, like something that we could get together and do as a group. Or maybe, just maybe, you did it because you didn't want me to fail. Right? Like, you don't know me, but you didn't want me up here waving my arms by myself because that would have looked awkward. I think that this motivation piece is really interesting. And it drives us to do the work that we do. It connects us to each other, and it helps us connect with our students in a way that we've not often thought about. One definition of the word motivation is a general desire or willingness of someone to do something. And oftentimes we have students that are interested in doing that thing, they're willing, but they don't have the steps to get through. Like going to class, for instance. I want to tell you a story about an actual student at Robert Morris University whose name we'll call Tyreek. And Tyreek needed some help finding the right steps. And in some of those cases, his steps were really big. Tyreek is an African-American male, first generation, and did really well in his high school. And came to Robert Morris University, and he started off doing really well. And then things had changed. He was not doing well in a lot of his courses, and so a campaign had brought him into the office, and he sat down, and I said, Tyreek, I can see that you're a smart man. What happened? And he said, I don't know. I just lost motivation. It's hard to explain. See, there's that word, motivation. So I got up. I closed the door to my office, and I sat back down, and I said, so I'm going to ask you again, Tyreek, what happened this semester? And I want you to be honest with me. It's just you and me right now. And he kind of looked back at the closed door, and he took a deep breath, and he said, when I get the first bad grade, it crushes me, and I stay in my room. I literally can't move, and I'm super depressed, and I'm super anxious. And then his eyes started to get watery, and he said, and I just can't handle the pressure of disappointing my mom, and I don't know if anyone knows what that feels like to be so overwhelmed that you can't handle the pressure of disappointing your mom. The thing is, I did. When I was a kid, I was a people pleaser. I loved affirmation, and I was always seeking it. And so that looked a lot of different ways, and my family was very well respected, and so there's this pressure to be successful and to be okay in every situation. And I was always on, and it was draining. I was smart, but I wasn't super smart, and when my smarts weren't enough, I worked really hard. And when that wasn't enough, I did what I could to be out in front. Right, and so some of those things were wild and crazy things, like singing in an a cappella quartet, or doing mixed martial arts, or jumping out of a plane. I was always doing things to put myself out there so people didn't see what was beneath. And I didn't want anybody to know that I struggled with my own identity as a black man. I didn't want people to realize that I was self-conscious about the way that I sounded as a black man, because I certainly didn't sound like other black boys in my high school. And high school kids have this really kind way of letting you know when you don't when you don't fit into a box. I grew up in a two-parent home, and I went to a black church. And if you know anything about the black church, when you mess up, it's not just your mom who gives you the business, but it's Miss Mamie, it's the deacon, it's the usher, and then it's your mom. And even though it sucked getting in trouble, it was awesome having a village of people to support you. In fact, I'd say a lot of my confidence came from when I was little. I would get up in front of the church and recite these verses, and if I'd mess up, this little old lady would say, "That's okay, baby, you take your time." I will. Some researchers call this village concept other mothering. And as awesome as this idea is, having this village of people to support you, the flip side of this, for a pleaser like myself, is that that's a whole village of people that could be disappointed in you. And if you took all of those people in my village, none of their disappointments combined were as weighty as the pressure I felt to not disappoint my mom. So when Tyreek was saying, "This is really overwhelming," I got it. And I knew that in that moment, Tyreek needed a partner to work with him out of this space that he was currently in. So I said to Tyreek, "Thank you for sharing that with me. And I need you to know that I see you. And if you're willing, we can get through this together." Things were getting a little bit deep in the conversation, so I said, to kind of shift us into a new space, I said, "Tyreek, tell me something that you did that you're super proud of." And he said that when he was in high school, he used to run cross country because he would start this race and he loved the idea of running and exerting energy and then crossing the finish line, even if he didn't come in first place. And I said, "That's awesome. I certainly will not be running with you though, because this is a very hilly campus. Robert Morris is very hilly." I was like, "But I like where your head's at. What about push-ups? Can you do push-ups?" And he said, "Yeah." I said, "Can you do 15 push-ups?" He said, "Yep." I said, "Can you do 25 push-ups?" He said, I guess. I mean, I might struggle a little bit." And I was like, "Okay. So let's get down and do 25 push-ups." And so in my suit and tie, and he in his shorts and t-shirt, we got down on the floor in my office and we did 25 push-ups. And we got up and I said, "That was awesome." You see, prior to those 25 push-ups, Tyreek could not even see daily moments of success that he was having. And I knew that he needed something in that moment that he could be proud of. And so I said, "Tyreek, that was cool. Like, you had a desire to do this thing, and you did it. And so I want you to do it again tomorrow. And when you do, I want you to text me. Can you do that, Tyreek?" "Yes, sir." "And I want you to do it the next day, and the next day, and the next day." "And I want you to do these push-ups 7 days in a row, because we're going to build some habits, some good habits." And he seemed both proud and relieved, and he agreed. And then I made a pretty bold move. I said, "Tyreek, this conversation's been pretty heavy. You've got a lot on your shoulders. And so I'm going to walk you up right now to the counseling center." And he agreed. And that was huge, because research suggests that students of color will not go to a counseling center for a variety of reasons. One of those reasons is that we ask for help differently, right? Another reason is that walking into the counseling center, there's no one that looks like me, and so we have a hard time believing that you could possibly understand what daily life is like as a black student on a predominantly white institution. We make that assumption so we don't go. And you combine all of that with the stereotype that black men are strong and we don't get depressed, right? Except in 2015, my older brother, who is brilliant and strong and I look up to, was battling depression, and nobody knew that until he took his life. And so I don't really like stereotypes in general, but that stereotype in particular, I hate. And don't you dare tell me that black men aren't hurting on your campus. Given all of this, I was super proud of Tyreek for agreeing to go to the counseling center with me and being willing to take these small, daily, measurable steps of success. And before we went up to the counseling center, we put together a plan. And that plan included downloading guide so that he had some things that he could check off and work towards every week. That plan included doing 25 push-ups a day and then texting me. That plan included writing in his journal every evening. That plan included drinking more water and calling his mom every day. I was so proud of Tyreek. At the end of our session, I told him, listen, man, I believe in you. You're going to do this. And I'm super proud of you. And I went to give him like a bro hug, you know, like the half. I came in like this, and he put both arms around me, and he didn't let go, and I could feel him shaking with relief. I wish I could tell you that everything was all peaches and roses right now. It's not. There's still a lot of work to do. But we're moving in the right direction. Tyreek, after our conversation, was diagnosed with severe depression, and this gave him a means to talk to his mom. It legitimized where he was coming from, so he wasn't just an emotional millennial or super sad or upset, but he had this reason, this way to talk to his mom. And he comes down to the center once a week and gets tutoring. And he texted me on last Thursday and he said, Dr. Spradley, my classes are going well and my relationships are going well too. I hope this story reminds us that sometimes a student just needs a person behind the technology who's willing to help them see the steps that they need to take in their collegiate journey. First, understanding them as a person and then helping to motivate them along their way. It's amazing what we can do with the right motivation. Thank you.